Okay. Good evening, everyone. Warm welcome to all of you all on behalf of the Forum of Cardiac Anesthesia. So today we'll be discussing about pain management options following cardiac surgery. So we'll not be, it'll be a regional anesthesia on the recent advances in the regional anesthesia techniques following sternotomy in cardiac surgery. What are the recent techniques that are available for us to be used in our patients? So as you all know, the opioid due to the opioid crisis, world over, there has been a push to reduce the usage of opioids in cardiac surgery patients, and also a push towards fast tracking of cases. So keeping the adverse effects of opioids in mind, there has always been a lot of interest in using non-opioid based analgesia in, and that has been a limiting factor following cardiac surgery due to the sternotomy. So Dr. Swetha from Narayana will discuss about the latest, about a recent journal that has explored these particular options that are available to us. Dr. Swetha? Swetha, can you unmute yourself before you start speaking?
Am I audible, sir?
You're audible now.
Hello.
Yes, Swetha, you can go ahead.
Yeah. Good evening, everybody. Today we'll be discussing pain relief following sternotomy in the conventional cardiac surgery, a review of non-neuraxial regional nerve blocks. So as we all know, acute postoperative pain following sternotomy in cardiac surgery should be adequately managed so as to avoid adverse hemodynamic consequences and pulmonary complications. In the era of fast tracking, adequate and efficient technique of post-operative analgesia enables early extubation, mobilization, and discharge from intensive care unit. Pharmacological therapies like NSAIDs and IV opioids, although being mainstay of the post-op pain management, don't match the quality of analgesia offered by the regional anesthesia. So due to increasing expertise in ultrasound-guided blocks, there is a recent surge in trial of bilateral nerve blocks for pain relief following sternotomy. So before proceeding to the individual nerve blocks, we need to know about the nerve supply of the chest wall. The chest wall is mostly supplied by branches of intercostal nerves. The ventral ramus of T1 to T11 spinal nerves form the intercostal nerves. However, it is the anterior division of the 2nd to 6th thoracic intercostal nerves that supply most of the anterior chest wall. So figure A on the left side shows the intercostal nerves which lie within the neurovascular bundle situated in the intercostal groove of each rib. After reaching the angle of the rib, it divides to give lateral cutaneous branch, which further divides into anterior and posterior branches. The anterior cutaneous branch divides into medial and lateral branches close to the lateral border of the sternum. All these nerves branches penetrate the muscle, fascia, and collateralize along their course to provide the sensory innervation of the whole chest wall. So the figure on the right side shows additional nerve supply of the chest wall and the axilla by the branches of brachial plexus. Now we will discuss about the different blocks. First block I would like to discuss is paravertebral block. Paravertebral block is a technique where local anesthetic is injected into space adjacent to the vertebrae to block spinal nerves as they emerge from the intervertebral foramen. As we can see in the figure A, thoracic paravertebral space is wedge-shaped space adjacent to the thoracic vertebral column. The boundaries of the paravertebral space medially is vertebral body and the intervertebral foramen. Anterolaterally, it is pleura. posteriorly costotransverse ligament and internal intercostal membrane laterally. These two structures are continuous with one another. The contents of paravertebral space includes adipose tissue, anterior ramus of intercostal nerves, posterior ramus of intercostal nerves, sympathetic chain, and rami communicants. The thoracic paravertebral space communicates medially with the epidural space, laterally with the intercostal space, superiorly with the cervical paravertebral space, and inferiorly it is limited due to the origin of psoas major muscle. Figure B demonstrates the sagittal section showing landmark technique. So the classical landmark technique uses loss of resistance to air or saline for identification of the space. Either multiple level single shot block or single level injection with catheter insertion can be performed. A 22 gauge spinal needle or 18 gauge Tuhoi needle, if catheter is to be placed, is inserted 2.5 to 3 cm lateral to the spinous process. The needle is advanced perpendicularly till the transverse process is contacted, and then it is walked over till the loss of resistance is felt. Around 15 to 20 ml of 0.375 to 0.5% of bupivacaine produces effective sensory blockade over 4 to 5 dermatomes. This is a landmark. This will be the landmark technique, but nowadays, as we have USG, we can use USG guided paravertebral block, which is much safer than the landmark technique. Following is the video showing USG guided paravertebral block. Here the demonstrator has held the probe, high frequency linear probe, parasagittally. He's showing T3, T4 process, and shining pleura and costotransverse ligament can be seen just below the T3, T4 process. He is piercing the needle in plane to the probe, very close to the probe. We have to continuously see for the pleura, that is lung sliding sign. Here he has pierced the costotransverse ligament just above the pleura. Now, as he gave that injection, the pleura was pushed down. Now, moving on to the second block, that is parasternal intercostal block. The procedure of this block involves injection of local anesthetic solution bilaterally from the second to sixth intercostal space just before placement of the sternal wires. This is usually supplemented with infiltration of local anesthetic solution over periosteum and infiltration around the chest tubes. The intercostal blocks, this intercostal blocks, blocks the anterior cutaneous branch, which is the terminal portion of the main trunk of the intercostal nerve. In this block, generally, 40 ml of 0.25%, that is 20 ml of 0.25% diluted with 20 ml of normal saline, that is total of 40 ml, 2 ml in each space bilaterally, so that will be 4 ml on second to sixth intercostal space will be given,
right.
And the remaining 10 ml will be given at the chest tube sites and that periosteum. So total 40 ml will be injected to give this block for effective analgesia post-sternotomy. Now moving on to the pectoral nerve blocks. Pectoral nerve blocks, it is a less invasive, effective facial plane block of the thoracic region. To understand the pectoral nerve blocks, one should know the anatomy of the axillary region. The anterior wall is formed by the pectoralis major and underlying pectoralis minor and subclavius muscle. The medial wall consists of serratus anterior and the thoracic wall, that is ribs and intercostal muscles. The lateral wall is formed by intertubercular groove of the humerus, and posterior wall is formed by subscapularis, teres major and latissimus dorsi. The contents of this region are axillary artery and its branches, axillary vein and its tributaries, axillary lymph nodes and brachial plexus and its branches. So pectoral nerve blocks includes PEX-1 and PEX-2 block. PEX-1 includes the injection of drug between pectoralis major and minor at the level of second to third rib. It blocks the medial pectoral and lateral pectoral nerves. PEX-2 block include injection of 20 ml of drug between pectoralis minor and serratus anterior at the level of third and fourth rib in an inferolateral direction from PEX-1 injection. It blocks the intercostal nerves, thoracodorsal nerve and long thoracic nerve of the bell. This is the demonstration of PEC-1 and PEC-2 block, USG guided PEC-1 and PEC-2 block. The probe is placed on the chest wall just medial to the coracoid process in a parasympathetic. The demonstrator is standing at the head end of the patient with hand abducted 90 degrees. And there is an in-plane needle that is going through the probe. The probe is placed just medial to the coracoid process. Now you can see PEC major, PEC minor and axillary artery beneath. Now he has tilted the probe to see the second rib, axillary vein and axillary artery, along with PEC major and PEC minor. Now the probe will be translated down for every intercostal space. Now the third rib is seen, and fascial plane between PEC major and PEC minor is infiltrated with local anesthesia for PEX-1 block. Now he moves down to fourth rib, fourth intercostal space. Now there is serratus anterior and the block between PEC minor and serratus is called as PEX-2. This is PEX-1 block. Of local anesthetic solution is injected between PEC major and PEC minor. Moving down a few centimeters, we now see the fourth rib, the two PEC muscles, and now he has moved down. The layers unzipping here nicely. This requires slightly more volume, and we find that 20 mils does the job nicely. Now there is 20 ml injection given between PEC minor and serratus anterior for PEC 2 block. Moving on to the erector spiny block. Erector spiny comprises the group of deep muscles of the back. They run bilaterally from the skull to the pelvis and sacral region and from the spinous to transverse process extending to the ribs. As we can see in the diagram, erector spiny lies beneath the trapezius and rhomboidus major muscle. So the needle has to traverse these muscles before reaching the desired plane. The mechanism of action is believed to result from the diffusion of local anesthetic anteriorly to block ventral and dorsal rami of the spinal nerves. A total of 20 ml of 0.375% ropivacaine on each side as a single shot, or 12 ml of 0.5% ropivacaine bolus followed by 10 ml 0.2% ropivacaine every 90 minutes on each side as a continuous block can be given. The major advantage of this block is that it produces an effect similar to the thoracic paravertebral blockade without the potential danger of needle injuring the pleura. On the right side, you can see the image, USG image of the erector spiny block, where the erector spiny lies below the trapezius and rhomboidus major, and transverse processes and erector spiny muscle, the arrow shown is the plane where the local anesthetic agent is injected. So this is the video demonstration of erector spiny block. We want to start by imaging ribs, then select medially until we see the transition to the transverse process. Here's an image of the ribs. You can see the rounded profile.
is sliding on either side. And as you move medially, there's a distinct shift to a new structure. That's Ranzer's process, which is much more square.
The demonstrator just showed that the ribs are present laterally. So he moved the probe from lateral to medial so that the ribs are seen as a transverse process, that rounded structure like rib converts into a squarish process like transverse process. Now he's tracing the first rib so that he can count the process intercostal space where the block can be given. He has held the probe parasagittally, laterally to the sternum, and there is an in-plane injection of the local anesthetic. The needle is going from caudate to cephalate direction. So he has given the local anesthesia agent between the transverse process and erector spiny muscle. Now you can see that there is a hydrodissection because of the local anesthetic agent is separating the transverse process from the erector spiny. Now moving on to the pecto-intercostal facial plane block. This block has only been performed under USG guidance. Pecto-intercostal facial plane block aims to block anterior cutaneous branch of the intercostal nerves. In the figure A, we can see anterior cutaneous branch lying between the pectoralis major and internal intercostal muscles. And in figure B, it shows the deposition of local anesthetic agent between the pectoralis major and internal intercostal muscles. So now we will see the USG demonstration of pecto-intercostal facial plane block. Again, it is a parasagittal in-plane approach for pectointercostal facial plane block post-sternotomy. A linear ultrasound transducer is placed in a parasagittal region 2 to 3 centimeters lateral to the lateral border of the sternum. The probe is placed 2 to 3 centimeters lateral to the sternum border. The needle is piercing the skin, subcutaneous tissue, pectoralis major muscle, and the intercostal muscles. Now you can see the hydrodissection caused by this drug between the pectoral major and the internal intercostal muscles. An echogenic needle in advanced in plane in a cranial to caudal orientation under ultrasound until the tip is identified between the pectoralis major and external intercostal. A 1 to 2 milliliter bolus of saline is then injected to confirm interfascial spread. After confirmation, 10 to 15 milliliters of local anesthetic is injected. In this patient, 15 milliliters is injected contralateral. So as we saw in the video, on the surface plane, subcutaneous tissue is identified. The pectoralis major muscle, intercostal muscle, and ribs are seen in the intermediate plane, and the lung along with pleura are identified in the deep plane. Generally, a 22 gauge 8 cm echogenic needle is inserted and advanced till it lies in the plane between pectoralis major and internal intercostal muscle. 0.25% of ropivacaine 15 ml on each side can be given for effective analgesia. Now we'll move on to transversus thoracic muscle plane block. This is the most recent block and is generally practiced widely. Transversus thoracic belongs to the internal intrinsic muscles of the chest wall. Transversus thoracic originates from the posterior surface of the body of sternum, xiphoid process, and sternal ends of the costal cartilages of 4th to 7th ribs, and it inserts on the costal cartilages of 2nd to 6th ribs. Now the local anesthetic solution is injected in the plane between the transversus thoracic and internal intercostal muscle. It will block the anterior branch of thoracic intercostal nerves. So with the high frequency linear probe, 1 cm lateral to the sternum, block is performed by inserting a needle in the plane at 3rd to 4th rib interspace and placing it between transversus thoracis and internal intercostal muscle. So after confirming the plane with hydrodissection, single bolus injection of large volume local anesthetic agent, generally 0.375% of levobupivacaine, 20 ml on either side of the sternum is given. Alternatively, you can use 0.3 to 0.5% ropivacaine 20 ml each side. So this is the USG image showing the needle piercing between the intercostal muscles and transversus thoracic muscle, and local anesthesia is given between these two. So we will see the video demonstrating the transversus thoracic plane block.
Block is a little different, and that's because of the presence of the internal mammary vessels that are deep to the intercostal muscle. We need to ensure we see it clearly throughout the block procedure, and capturing it in cross-section using a transverse orientation is the safest way. You can see the slips of transversus thoracic muscle in blue here. The needle will pass through both pec and intercostal muscles in the right vascular plane between intercostal and transversus thoracic. Is a little different, and that's because of the presence of the internal mammary vessels that are deep to the intercostal muscle. We need to ensure we see it clearly throughout the block procedure.
So here the demonstrator is saying that for transversus thoracic plane block, generally in all the other blocks you must have seen that the probe was held paramedially in a parasagittal section and in-plane approach was used. Now the demonstrator is saying that because the internal mammary artery lies beneath transversus thoracic muscle, generally the in-plane approach, you will miss the artery or vein and inadvertent intravascular injection will go.
If we rotate 90 degrees to the parasagittal ori cartilages and at the pleura, which almost looks like a nice target for intercostal block, this is the internal mammary vein. Shifting the probe laterally brings up the pulsatile mammary artery and then back to the vein again. Anytime you're imaging vessels in long axis, it can be easy to miss them. Doing the TTP block in the parasagittal orientation requires very careful attention to these vessels, which can be not all that obvious. So here we are back to the transverse view. The probe obviously has to be positioned between the ribs to see the soft tissue structures. And once again, intercostal and the internal mammary artery just above the pleura. It's hard to say where, if at all, the transversus thoracic muscle is. The needle is advanced from the lateral aspect, passing through the pec muscle. A small injection to hydrolocate the needle tip shows the needle is advanced another few millimeters, and the test injection is repeated until we see the injectate depressing the pleura and spreading medially. 20 mils are then administered here. The block is a little different, and that's because of the presence.
So that was transversus thoracic muscle plane block, in which the demonstrator told that it's better to use the transverse, it's better to place the probe transversely and then use the in-plane approach so that you should not inadvertently give injection in intermammary or vein, artery or vein. So the other blocks, it was parasagittally in-plane approach. In generally, transversus thoracic plane block, it will be transverse approach. So now just to summarize, pectoralis nerve block includes PEC1 and PEC2 block. So PEC1 will target lateral and medial pectoral nerves. The target plane for PEC1 will be between pectoralis major and minor, and the area covered will be anterior chest wall. For PEC2, it will target intercostal nerves, that is T2 to T6, long thoracic nerve of Bell and thoracodorsal nerve. And the target plane will be between pectoralis minor and serratus anterior, and it will cover anterior and lateral part of chest wall as well as the axilla. In erector spiny block, the target nerve will be dorsal and ventral rami of the spinal nerve roots. The target plane will be deep to the erector spiny muscle at the level of T6 transverse process. And the area covered will be anterior and posterior chest wall, axilla, and the medial aspect of the upper arm. The pecto-intercostal facial plane block targets the anterior cutaneous branches of intercostal nerve. The target plane will be between pectoralis major and internal intercostal muscle on the lateral style of the sternal margin. And it covers the medial part of the chest wall. The transversus thoracic muscle plane block targets the multiple anterior cutaneous branches of thoracic T2 to T6 segments. The target plane will be between transversus thoracic muscle and intercostal muscles, and medial part of the chest wall, including internal mammary area, will be covered. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Shweta, for that excellent presentation of the regional techniques for relief of pain.
Thank you, sir.
Following cardiac surgery, it's a very, very important aspect which all of us must pay attention to. Pain after cardiac surgery is often related to median sternotomy and chest tubes and peaks around the second postoperative day. And because of the problems associated with the opioids, we need to look into alternative techniques. And here comes the local anesthetic techniques, which you have described very well done with the video representations.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Prabhu Shankar, Anu, comments and questions, please.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
It's a nice presentation, sir. Now, to avoid opiates, toxicities and all, these regional techniques plays a very important role, not only in the cardiac surgeries, it also plays a very important role in the cath procedures like implantations of various pulse generators, ICDs. And also now it plays, it has got a lot of advantage, like preventing the arrhythmias, intraoperative periods and postoperative. Hello.
Yes.
Then it increases the various advantages there. It increases the coronary circulations. It attenuates this. So many advantages there, sir. Not only improves the respiratory systems.
Yes.
It also plays an important role in reducing the length of stay in the ICUs, ventilatory supports. It plays a very important role, sir, post-operative, especially intra and also the post-operative period. Previously, we used to use only the opiates as adjuvants to avoid so many adverse effects. It plays a regional technique, plays a very important role. And it's a nice presentation, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Prabhu Shankar, for those comments. And also, epidural, thoracic epidural has been used for a long time, but there's a real risk of
adverse effects and, is more.
And there's a bloody tap, it's a difficult situation. So, as an alternative to that technique, these techniques may be utilized for the best possible risk benefit ratio.
Any adverse effects, like, sir, hematomas? Toxicities
will occur if there is intravascular injection and if you are exceeding the dose limits. Otherwise, there is no problem. You have to avoid intravascular injection by aspirating before you actually start to inject, and also calculate the dose of the drugs which you are giving and see whether you are crossing the upper limit of the recommended dose.
Local trauma, sir, hematomas and all. Which causes
they are not significant. No. They have no
pleural injuries. Pneumothorax or anything.
Yeah, pleural injuries can occur, but
for PEX 1 and PEX 2 blocks, as Dr. Prabhu Shankar has rightly pointed out, yes, there is a risk for hematoma, the muscle injury, because if the plane is not, you have to do it under USG guidance. But if you do not inject in the correct plane, chance for hematoma, because we are injecting, you have to inject a large volume of local anesthetic for the block to be effective. So if you do not inject into the correct plane, there is a chance for hematoma or muscle soreness to happen. And that itself can produce a significant amount of pain. But if you are injecting into the correct plane between the two muscles, then it's a very good block, and it, I mean, if you give it bilaterally,
yes,
you can get good amount of analgesia,
especially minimally invasive techniques.
Correct.
All
correct.
Plays that's a very right, important
yes.
role.
Yes.
So how does it causes preconditioning, sir? Ischemic preconditioning, regional technique. Hello.
I am not sure about ischemic preconditioning with these regional blocks. Murlidhar sir, do you have any comments on that one?
Not really. Yes.
I'm
Sweta,
not
can you elaborate on that?
What, sir?
Shweta can tell us about that.
I don't know. I don't think the article has mentioned anything about ischemic preconditioning with regional. That was
no, sir. Article has not mentioned anything.
Yeah. That is more for neuraxial blocks.
Okay.
Yeah, for non-neuraxial blocks, ischemic preconditioning, I don't know. I'm not aware of any paper which has discussed that. I can look into that one. I'm not sure about it at the moment.
And also, it's said that this one, what? Anti-inflammatory also.
Yes, that is true. So all regional anesthesia techniques, they reduce the surgical stress response. They give good analgesia and the post op recovery is also pretty good if administered correctly. And as you had rightly pointed out, in the era of minimally invasive surgeries, these non-neuraxial blocks are gaining more importance. Because in that case, you don't have to give bilateral blocks. You only have to give unilateral blocks. And you can give opiate-free analgesia for such patients. So, and also because we are targeting minimally invasive surgery, fast tracking is inherent in that one. So when you're using a non-opiate-based analgesia, that there is a fast tracking and you'll be able to discharge the patient from your ICU faster with a better pain tolerance for the patient. Any attendees over here who has experience in practically delivering any of these blocks? Please feel free for your experience.
Hello, sir.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Good.
Is there any? Is Dr. Nagraj is there? Dr. Nagraj. Hello.
Sir, sorry to interrupt in between, sir. There is one question from Dr. Rosa.
Yes.
Read it out.
Elaborate the usage of each block. What are all different procedures can be done under blocks?
See, we discussed now. There's so many cath lab procedures like. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Not only the cath lab procedure like various implantations, ICDs implantations. And also nowadays, TAVI plays a very important role. They also play an important role. Now the regional technique, patient who are undergoing for this one.
Transapical approach.
Yeah, transapical procedures. And now nowadays, the robotic, it's upcoming. It plays an important role.
Yes.
Any other?
On this note, Shweta,
can you answer that question?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Can you answer that question? There was a question about which block is suitable for which condition.
Sir, generally, all these blocks are mainly, I have discussed this block mostly for the pain after the sternotomy. I mean, in the ICU, just because we use too much of opioids and epidural is generally not favorable. So non-neuraxial blocks are most favored for these things. And so that there will be early extubation and early mobilization of the patients. But all these blocks can be used for different other surgeries also. As sir also said that you can use this in cath labs. Other breast surgeries and extensive breast surgeries also we can use PEC-1, PEC-2 block. Non-cardiac surgeries also these blocks can be used. Intercostal drainage placements. These procedures also we can use the blocks. Just the dose of the drugs has to be calculated according to the weight of the patient and you can visualize the nerves in the USG and give the block.
Right. How about thoracotomies? Thoracotomies, what are the blocks?
Yes, sir. Thoracotomy, we can use pectointercostal facial plane block, we can use transversus thoracis, we can use, sir.
Paravertebral
block, erector spinae, yes, all these blocks can be used for thoracotomy as well, sir.
Shweta, did the article discuss anything about additives to the local anesthetic while we are administering these blocks?
Sir, few of the studies with PEC-1 and PEC-2 and some studies with erectrospiny block, they have given, for PEC-1 and PEC-2, people have used dexmedetomidine up to 25 micrograms. And in erectrospiny and pectointercostal, they have used up to 25 micrograms of fentanyl also, additives.
Okay. And any studies have discussed about using catheters for any particular blocks for continuous analgesia, or are these only applicable only within the OR?
No, sir. Continuous analgesia is also advised in case of pectointercostal facial plane block, erectrospiny blocks, and transversus thoracic plane block. All these plane block as well as the paravertebral block can be given as a continuous injections also.
So for continuous injection, they advise to thread catheters into these particular planes?
Yes, sir. In paravertebral, they advise to keep at least 1 to 2 centimeter of catheter in the paravertebral space, and then levobupivacaine or ropivacaine injections with at least 30 to 60 minutes of logout intervals should be kept for the doses.
For paravertebral and erectrospinal is quite evident.
Yes, sir.
What about the PEC-1 blocks and the pectointercostal blocks? Do they advise threading catheters into that one for those blocks as well?
For pectointercostal facial plane block, they have the studies are of general single shot only. For PEC-2, also large volume single shot only they have given. But for PEC-2, we can for PEC-2 we can put catheters, sir, up to 2 to 3 centimeters.
Okay. Because in the intensive care, and what about the single shot injections? How much duration are they suggesting? How
so
long?
First,
will that
we take? Have to calculate the dose for ropivacaine or levobupivacaine. Those are the cardiac stable drugs, and generally they have told to keep at least 90 minutes duration between the second dose if you want to give.
So that means they are advising multiple blocks if you want to give continuous.
They are suggesting multiple blocks if you want more analgesia and patient compliance.
Okay.
But the volume has to be adjusted and the total 24 hours duration has to be checked. If it should not cross the local anesthesia toxicity dose.
All right. Okay. Any other question from anyone?
Prabhu Shankar, can you make final comments and close the session?
Yes, sir. It's a nice presentation. I thanks Dr. Shweta Panse.
Thank you, sir.
For elaborating and demonstrating few slides with the help of USG. For future, it plays a very important role in the preventing the adverse effects of the opiates, and also for the better outcome of the patients in cardiac surgeries. Thank you all, sir.
Thank you.
Hello.
We'll meet again Sunday and next Monday.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you for all the attendees on behalf of Forum of Cardiac Anesthesia. We hope to meet you all next week.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.